Okay, so good morning, everyone. So I'm really glad that we have a lot of people today. So trainings are not really trainings. That's the thing that we do with MISP. When we do training at MISP, it's for getting feedback. So we are very selfish, to be honest. So if you are coming here for training with MISP, we want to get feedback from our users. And it could be user interface feedback, it could be bugs, reports, idea, and so on. And that's basically how MISP improved. It's a community of users. Circle is leading the development of MISP, but we really want to get feedback from user contribution from others. So feel free during the training to ask questions, provide feedback. If something is unclear, just tell us. And then this tiny URL links is not going to a spam link, no worries, no spear phishing, whatever. It's basically going to a HackMD website where you have question, open question, because sometimes people are shy to ask questions or they don't want to disturb the audience and so on. Feel free to just drop question there live, and then we will look at them directly, and then we can even answer directly. So it's one way to ask questions, but you can really shout in the audience and just ask your questions.
Yeah, we don't want to encourage you to use this instead of asking. It's just for those that don't want to ask openly, just write a question in there.
Yeah, exactly. So I have a first question. How many people are really using MISP on a day-to-day basis? Okay, great. So interesting. So today we will separate the session into two parts. One main part, the beginning of the morning before the lunch, would be more like about user perspective, how to use it, what are the features that we have in MISP. The thing is MISP grow organically, and you might have missed some features that we have, how we use it, and our feedback about how we use it as Circle for information sharing, how we build information sharing communities, and stuff like that. So the agenda is that one, but usually we are drifting, depending on feedback, idea, and so on. So that's usually the canva that we follow, but we are probably shifting, and it's great. I mean, it's not an issue if we are shifting to other idea and stuff like that, but that's basically the idea of today's agenda. So that's basically it. So usually we start with a kind of history about MISP, where it's coming from, and why we started MISP and so on. So the whole project itself and MISP as a software really started in 2012. So we were working with different thoughts at European level to share informations. And we discovered one of, I would say, big issues. Even if we were communicating between each other, we were communicating during meetings. So we were going to Brussels, Berlin, whatever, and then we were basically discussing there, and every 4 months we were sharing information about things that we were doing, malware that we were reversing, and talking about targeted attacks. But the pity was, when we were there one time, we discovered that we basically worked on the same malware, both teams, but without communicating about it. And that's everything where it started. At the same time, Christophe Van de Pla, at that time from the Ministry of Defense in Belgium, started a small project called SideFSeek, which was basically an initial version of MISP. And it was like, for us, a kind of thing that we were like, okay, we have a tools. We are capable of building tools. Why not using these tools, make it open source, and start work on it to share information? And at that time, it was just malware. And that's where the confusion sometimes with MISP, the initial names and came from that part. MISP, the M stands for malware. But nowadays, it's much more larger. So we don't exactly know for what M is standing for nowadays.
We like to say it's magic.
Yeah. So you can just think about your creativity and just replace the M with whatever thing you like. So you basically, it's an information sharing platforms and a threat intelligence platforms. And nowadays the platform is completely community driven. It's an open source platform, but the project grows into more than 43 repositories on the GitHub organization page. The project is nowadays pretty large. Within our teams, we are basically like 5 or 6 people working full-time on MISP and related projects around. So it's really something that we are committed to work on. And MISP itself is one of our software that we use. So it's something that we use day to day. So we basically developed it and we use it. So it's the very uncommon, I would say, approach, because a lot of organizations are asking software engineers to develop some things, then people are testing it and so on. Here, we basically have people developing it and testing at the same time and using it on a day-to-day basis. So that's maybe why we are really eager to get feedback from other users to improve the platform.
Yeah, one of the things that we also try to do with this is, since we're also users of it, we try to build the software in a way of what we need right now. So when something pops up, we see a need for something in our community or either ourselves in-house, we try to build as rapidly as possible. So this is when we get sometimes questions about long-term roadmap and so on. And where our long-term roadmap basically is, depends what we'll see in a month, depends what we'll see in 2 months and what pops up and what we need to be able to share, what we need to be able to process.
Yes, the idea is really that we have a software that's supporting analysts, incident responders, and others doing threat intelligence at large. And that's really what the thing behind. So, and that's the evolution of it. And initially, as I was mentioning, that MISP was really targeting the reverse. So people doing analysis of malware, sharing samples, doing static analysis, reversing a specific aspect, and so on, and just sharing back the information. Then the project was growing more and more. So people were starting to share information, and then you have some other people that were doing more defensive aspect of the security. And so that, for example, a lot of IP addresses, indicators were shared within MISP. And then we were like, okay, maybe we should improve the platforms to support those use cases too. And we have seen that if you have malware reversers starting to share information, this information can be used by others to basically feed their IDS, protect their infrastructures, do detections and stuff like that. And then over time, what we have seen is more and more communities were growing and more people were basically putting information and sharing information. And from that information, you start to have more use case and people using it. And then afterwards, we had people that were more interested into like tracking attackers, tracking what they are doing and what kind of campaigns they have and so on. And you have seen that some of the other users, like people that are, for example, tracking ExploitKit, tracking specific aspects of some group or cyber criminals, we're using MISP to basically gather this information and then expand it to add more contextual information and basically look for the campaigns and what are the motive and the objective of the attackers. And then when we were digging into that, we discovered that more and more people were using it. And we had some additional use cases, like law enforcement started to say, okay, if we see the machines, they might need to have any information in advance to know if the machine is already infected, is already targeted, whatever. So they basically say, okay, maybe we should connect to MISP communities, get the information and use it for forensic analysis. And then afterwards, starting to use it, they were like, okay, but maybe we should use the same approach between different law enforcement organizations and start to share information. And that's basically how the communities are growing. And nowadays we have, for example, in Luxembourg, we had a lot of discussion with banks. Banks are targeted with malware. But sometimes they have additional information that they would like to share within the bank sector, within the banking sector, such as bank account details, new account, and stuff like that. And we extended MISP to support that. And that's why nowadays the M for malware is basically kind of outdated, because we basically use it for everything. So as long as you can describe how you want to share information, you can really use the platform to share additional information. Nowadays we have this GoAML export, where you can basically export directly from MISP anti-money laundering format, and then you can even share it back to other systems. So you can really design the system as you wish for sharing information.
Yeah, one of the things that becomes obvious from what Alexandre explained, that there are basically two types of ways how our communities of sharing have grown. One of them is more of a vertical approach, where you have someone producing data during their day-to-day business, and then someone that is interested in the output of that groups takes it as an input and then produces further output that might be interesting for the next group. So there is this vertical type of sharing, but there's also a horizontal one where different types of organizations get interested, either because they have a security team that is already using MISP and getting indicators through that way, or because they simply just want to find a way to share information. We already have the vehicle for that basically ready. So we have a sharing platform that is pretty flexible with what type of data you can share. So for anyone in here and anyone interested in this, or if you know anyone that might be interested in this, we're always looking for new types of sharing, new types of communities that could share. One of the reasons why we're interested in this is because, for example, imagine that one of these organizations once has an incident that is related to our field. They already have the means to communicate with us then by default, by having a MISP setup or being used to the process of how to share information without it getting into the way of doing a first time sharing when something happens. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to bridge these different types of communities. our biggest hurdle in this, of course, is that we're pretty limited in what we see and what types of sharing we can imagine for ourselves, since we're coming from one field, basically. So we're trying to find partners that are that have the know-how on what kind of information should be shared in their communities. If you're from one of those organizations, get in touch with us. Let us know what you would see as useful information to be shared, and we will make it happen for you.
So the thing is, another question that we had very often, in addition to the roadmap, so everyone is asking about the roadmap and so on, and as we mentioned, we have a very short-term roadmap. It's really based on incident we have, or community requirement, and stuff like that. But we discovered that basically we have a model of governance, even if it's not a formalized one that you can find with like 40 pages describing the governance of the project. But it's how we get information and so on. And I think for us it's quite important. It's basically how we gather information. So we basically gather information through the trainings like we do today. We do a summit every year. So we do the fourth one in October in Luxembourg, where we basically get users using this, describing what they are doing with it, or extending it and so on. It's a nice opportunity, for example, to show off what you are doing. Then one of the major, obviously, feedback that we get is through GitHub. A lot of the issues, feedback and so on is coming from GitHub. We have a channel called Gitter, where we basically have live chat with users. So you have people contributing there directly, asking for support and so on. And then we basically support various user groups. They are not always managed by us, but where we are coming in and talking about potential roadmap and prioritize what kind of features we want. Because the thing is, information sharing can be pretty large. What we try to do is to basically be able to have generic things that can be reused by various people. And what we try to do in those different user groups is to basically find out what are the features that everyone is needing, is in need, and then we implement them into MISP. As an example, we are participating to some user group at NATO. NATO is one of the users of MISP, and they have some specific requirements to the military sector. On the other end, we are participating at some user group, or it's the NGO. Whereas the NGO, it's basically having some requirements. But even if you find it awkward, they might have the same requirements on both sides. Maybe they don't express it in the same way, but you can basically get this kind of information and then implement it back into MISP. And that's, for us, one of the most important parts is really getting feedback from users and trying to basically prioritize the list of requirements from those different user groups into a list of features, and we prioritize on those ones.
Something that is always difficult for us is sometimes we get some pretty niche requests that we don't really understand or fully anticipate how it's going to be used in the end. And what helps us in this case is if some users form a user group and they say, we're representing, for example, the financial sector of this country, and we have this need because we all purchased a certain tool that we want to interact with. This is a format that we need support for. Then if you come to us as part of one of these self-organized user groups, you can convey this message to us, and we already know that there are certain organizations behind it. One of the things that sometimes gets lost is sometimes we get some feature requests on Twitter by an egg account that we don't know and says, okay, we need support for this tool. And we have no idea if there's a real need for it in the community. So having these self-organized user groups really helps us in the decision-making process on what goes on our short-term roadmap. So just take the initiative if you're part of a community like that. Organize a user group. It is nothing formal, so we don't expect anything like that. And then get in touch with us and convey the messages from your users to us.
And there's an additional area where we get feedback, and which is basically more an experimental area. It's where within the core team, we experiment stuff. So the first thing that we discover within this project, we do a lot of mistakes, but we are not afraid of those. So we basically do a mistake, start to do an implementation of something, see that it's basically not working, we just discard it. So we are not there for basically just keeping things rolling out and forever without thinking about it. So we really want to basically, so we are always very, I would say, critical within our team. Like someone is doing something and say, oh yeah, but you have some feedback that is basically maybe something that needs to be changed. So we try to work on that way. And for example, some of the things that we developed, like the taxonomies, galaxies and so on, came from those kind of discussion and so on. And we implemented, for example, the taxonomies to solve a specific problem that was a specific classification problems. But we discovered that over the time, it was basically useful for everyone to basically being able to classify the information. And that's where a lot of things are coming in. We try, and if it succeeds, we continue to use it. And if we think that it's basically a mistake or something that needs to be improved, we improve it. On the other hand, we do the same for the core development. Recently, we had a lot of feedback regarding the API, that they were not consistent, things that were basically could be improved. So we just released the 2.4.95 today, and this one is including a lot of changes in the API. So it's still backward compatible, but we extend it to make it completely consistent across the different export. And our objective is really basically to have it for the different export format and so on. But it's really coming from this kind of discussions where we say, okay, we are doing something wrong, we need to fix it. And that's, so we don't, for example, we don't hide anything. So everything is on GitHub issues. You'll see all issue problems, things that people are not happy with, but it's fine. We are not selling anything. We are just an open source project. And we're trying to be as transparent as possible on the decision process of how we work within Lisp. So the thing is, when you start to use Lisp or build communities, you start to discover that you might bring new problems. And those problems are not really software problems, but are more related to how people are using information sharing and how people are using trade intelligence as is. What we have seen is in the different communities that we operate, that usually people have different objectives. And even within a single organization, a large company, you might have different teams with completely different objectives. Imagine that you share IP addresses that are used for a CNC for a malware. Some users are using it, obviously, for detections. And that's, I think, one of our core functionalities at the CCIRT, at Circle. When we share information, it's basically to be able to detect these things and to find out if someone is targeted, if someone is already infected, or if there are some traces of some intrusion or whatever. So that's really important. The detection part is, I would say, the core part. But on the other hand, you have some users that are going a bit further and want to block direct information. So they want to block, for example, IP addresses and so on. Imagine that you have telecom operators that are selling kind of security services. They want to block all those phishing websites for their customer as a services. So they have an interest of blocking. But already, if you have those two parts, it could be very divergent. Because the problem here is, if you have false positive in detections, okay, it's still manageable. I mean, if you have like a 2 or 3 or 5% false positive rate in the detection part, it's fine. On the other hand, if you start to block and you have a 5% false positive rate, and you start to block Facebook pages or whatever, you might run into trouble with your user base. So that's something that you have to keep in mind, and that's something that we try to solve in the platform. We will talk today about the different way of managing false positive, or you can expire informations, or you can basically tag it, do sightings and so on. And you see that those kind of things can be in the same platforms. It's just that you have different functionalities for different kind of users.
So basically, just to summarize this part, is our recommendation is always to be very lenient with discarding data that you share, but to be very strict with the data that you filter out of the system and that you feed your devices with. So as you can see with these different use cases, your organization might not have a need for detection, for example, just blocking. So if you're just doing that, for example, then a lot of things might seem as noise and junk data, basically, because they generate false positives. On the other hand, you're part of a community whenever you're sharing, and someone else in the community might want to track threat actors over long periods of time, and they're interested in historic data that is not relevant for blocking, for example, anymore. So make sure that instead of just discarding the data, not passing it on to your partners, to contextualize it and to use that contextualization to filter the data when you're feeding your tools for blocking.
Yeah, and even in addition to that, we have seen other use cases where people are using the platforms for doing kind of intelligence analysis without really looking into or being even interested into the false positive aspect. If you're using MISP, maybe some people already know the overlap matrix for the feeds. So we have a functionality in MISP where when you collect all the feeds, you can see the overlap between the different feeds. And we have discovered that some users are using it for procurement of feeds data. So they purchase feeds at different places. They don't exactly know what they are buying, but they want to see that if it's not seen already in some OSINT feed or is not already seen in some vendor feeds. So the idea behind is those kind of feeds are basically in the systems. And as Andras mentioned, is basically maybe some are junk, maybe some are not interesting, but it's still interesting to have those. And then you can discover that if he's purchasing one feed, which one is more interesting for his organizations than the one that is not. And that's a way to use the systems too. So we try to basically have features that are not blocking those different usage. And that's very important because it can be tough sometimes. I mean, some people are like complaining, oh, why do you share this information? It might be blocking stuff and so on. And that's why we introduce functionalities. We'll talk about the warning list, which is a complete mechanism for trying to figure out if we have already false positive or information that are linked to some known list of IP addresses or a list of indicators that might be false positive. But that's some kind of thing that we try to do. So we always try to figure out which user, which organization are interested and which kind of objectives. Sometimes they have all those three objectives. You might have CSIR that are interested in doing all those three activities. If you provide a feed for blocking for the national operators, yes, you do it. I mean, for example, for Circle, we are more on both detection and performance intelligence. Blocking, yes, not really our activities, but that's really depending on our day-to-day operation and how you work daily. So that's one of the problems, and those problems could be solved, I would say, partially technically or by processes and so on. Then you have additional processes when you share information. And those ones are much more complex to deal with. And the first one is basically something that you always see as trust, is social interactions, is how people are sharing information or willing to share information with other parties. And if you don't trust anyone around you, sometimes it might be difficult to share information. So what we have seen is there are ways to overcome those one. The first one that are coming, and it's usually the legal restrictions. Very often, people are like very afraid to share information because it might impact their, I would say, legal boundaries at national level, international level, European level. So they are scared of that. And what we try to do too is basically on the MIST project is to review everything that is existing that might benefit or hurt the information sharing aspect. For example, a lot of people are talking about GDPR. We did a complete document about GDPR. I mean, it's all fine to share information when you have a clear objective of doing information security and so on, but you have to basically clarify that. And as long as you clarify it, it's easier for everyone. There are other aspects that are interesting. Nowadays, we have seen some organizations that are coming to us and asking us, okay, I have an information sharing communities, but people are not sharing. And we are wondering why. And they are wondering. So for the past year, we were looking at all the different aspects. One of the aspects is the legal aspect. So for example, to register to a specific sharing communities, you have to sign a legal agreement of 14 pages with a lot of legal things. And then so after that, you can get access to the platform and start to share information. We have seen that this could be overcome sometimes. For our case, some years ago, we did that mistake too. So we were coming with like a new information sharing communities, having our lawyers proposing a complete legal agreement, like more than 10 pages. And then we start the platform. So we start the platform, we have this legal agreement, first organization joins, everything is fine. Then we had a second organization, a large US company that wanted to join the community and say, oh, it's fine, but I just read your document, but the sections 12 or whatever is not correct. And we were like, okay, but we cannot change it because if it's a sharing community with various people, if you ask for changing this one, we need to ask the other one to change those rules. And that's, you start really that you have a fundamental problems by creating those legal restrictions. So we came back to the blackboard and we said, okay, maybe we should change it. And so we had this discussion about with lawyers and or legal advisor and say, okay, could we get rid of those legal end user license agreements? And initially it was like, whoa, no, you must have one and so on. Then we discussed about the legal aspect. There is still national law, you still have a legal framework and so on, so you can still rely on that. And what we did, we get rid of it completely. And we just have two rules. The rule is everyone is responsible for their own data. And the second one, everyone has basically to follow the classification of the information. And that's it, nothing else. No other things. You can use information for commercial purpose. You can reuse it, bundle it into other information. You can qualify it. And then as long as you follow those two rules, it's fine. And for one of the communities that we operate on those rules, is more like 1,000 organizations nowadays are connecting on that one. So that means sometimes if you have to be creative on the legal aspect. But it's not applicable to everyone. I mean, in the military sector, for example, you might have very strict rules on sharing information, which makes sense too. So it's something that you have to evaluate the risk and the benefit of having a complex legal infrastructure. That's one of the things. Another thing that we have seen from other communities, it's some I would say attach rule. Like, for example, if you join this community, you must share information back. And what you have seen is not really successful for some community as having those kind of rules for a specific reason. People, for us, it's very important that people are using the data for detections, for maybe finding a new threat, maybe correlation and so on. It's very important for that people are using data. We don't really force people to share information. We just say, okay, maybe there's a benefit at the end that you start to share information. But what we have seen is some community that are forcing the way of sharing, that's those people are behaving in a very strange way. So to remain in the community, they start to share information. But what they do, they basically copy information from the internet, that is OSINT, and basically replicate information. They put low quality information in the system just to remain in the systems. So the rule itself is introducing a behavior that is basically just not very interesting either for them, neither for the group. And that's something that we have seen is we are used to say that we like free riders. People that are free riding on the data set and using the data is always better. There are some, we read a lot of academic papers on the discussions, and all the academic papers are completely forgetting about those. They always say that people have to, you know, share back, and it's always kind of bijections where you have those interactions between users. You have to kind of reach an equilibrium between the economics and so on. But the reality is a bit different. It's usually sometimes it's when people start to use the data, maybe after 1 year, 2 years, they start to share. We have seen some organizations that are sharing on the platform after 3 years of operations. So that means they are joining the platforms, they are using the data, or start to use it. After 1 year, they automate stuff. And then after 3 years, they start to say, okay, maybe we have an interest to share back.
Maybe something that's interesting here is that this has many different reasons, and understanding these reasons really help when you're building your community. So one of the things that always comes up is, what is the maturity of the organizations that you're dealing with? Very often you have organizations that when they start out, they don't have the maturity to share the information that they would like to share, or they would like to be able to share. And over time they will mature. But if you already are more inclusive from the start on, you will get them on board immediately when they start to get to a level where they can start sharing that information. The other thing is that there is a stigma about information out there, that the only information that should be shared is fully validated reports that have gone through your legal team and so on. Everything else is junk. The reality is that even very small pieces of information shared can be useful. For example, if I'm seeing that that one of the indicators I've gotten from one of my partners is generating a bunch of false positives, it's useful information to send that information back to them saying, hey, watch out, this one is a false positive. You might not want to use that. Adding additional information, for example, if you're subscribing to some services that allow you to expand the information that you've gotten from your partner and push those expansions back to them, that is useful information. So just validation, enrichment, and so on are fully valid pieces of information sharing. So this is why we're trying to move away from this whole full report or nothing idea and trying to build MISP in a way where it's more collaborative, where you can even build those small pieces of the puzzle into the full picture.
Yeah, we have an example with that, which was very interesting in Luxembourg. We had a very small bank. We showed them MISP. So it was basically one guy alone doing everything, IT, security, phones, whatever. So for obviously, they're not doing trade intelligence on a day-to-day basis. So we showed them MISP, and the guys were like, okay, it's nice, but I have no resources to basically just even look into it. And I was like, okay, he's right. I mean, he has no resources, there's no magic behind and so on. But we still gave them an access. So for the next month, they didn't use it. But one day, and that's something that's very interesting, is how people are thinking of. He received a kind of suspicious package for replacement of a software for back office in the bank. And there he was wondering, okay, it's suspicious, but I don't know what to do with it. So the guys had this great idea to just took the binaries, put it on MISP and say, do you know what it is? And then in MISP, you have a lot of reverser. And the funny part of it is, you know, those reverser, or we are part of those reverser too, we are really eager to get those fresh binaries, you know, things that are, we don't know, everyone knows about it. It's not on various total. Whoa, it looks interesting. So then they send it. After 2 hours, two people just like make proposal to the event and say, okay, there's a Trojan in that binaries that you send it to us. So it was an interesting approach. It was like, and that's, I would say, what Sandrash was explaining about. You don't need complete full report. if you start to have suspicious activities and things like that, it's better to share the information too early than too late.
And there is another aspect. Yeah. So what we've talked about here is mostly having technical hurdles or lack of maturity to be able to analyze something. But there is a full different aspect to it as well, which is the willingness to share. And what should be the motivation for an organization to share this information in the first place? One of the things that comes up very often is, okay, if we just let anyone in without requirements, they will be free riders and there will be no incentive to share. And what we've seen in our community is that the reason why this is not true is whenever you get something in your network and you're analyzing a malware and you have a report of that you either share or you don't share, and one thing to factor into the decision is that the data that you have there is the most relevant data for you that exists. It is something that was literally seen in your network. It either targets you as an organization personally, it targets your sector, it targets your region, something that affects you. Sharing that information out and getting feedback on it and additional validation, additional information related to that is the most important information that you yourself can get back in. So what happens very often is people share this information out there, share whatever they have, whatever they have seen, of course, redacting any personally identifiable information and so on, and then waiting for the community to look at it and enrich it with their own findings. So this is one of those things where having free riders can often change over time, not due to their change in their maturity, but because they will see the immediate benefit of sharing that information.
Yeah, exactly. So is the sharing discussion, tomorrow we'll maybe get a presentation, more details on how to set up sharing communities and so on, but it's normal to have those difficulties. And we are not limited to those difficulties. You have others. One of the examples that we had too is people want to share information and then discover that one of their adversaries are basically sharing information on the same platform. And then say, okay, is it good that we get information from them and so on? And there are some explanation that is very good sometimes. If you want to stabilize, for example, I would say between bracket peace of action between two actors, it happens that sometimes it's better to share information between those two actors because they already know the capabilities of two. And they basically start to say, okay, maybe I should avoid to go in that direction and so on. So even sometimes, even sharing information towards adversaries might be interesting too. So I know it's going to be controversial, but it's something not to underestimate nowadays. Okay, so now you need a software to do this kind of information sharing. So the MIS project itself, and that's what we were mentioning, is not anymore a single software alone. It's a set of things that makes the MIS project. The core aspect is really really important. It's basically the core part is a mix of PHP and Python, and this one is basically supporting the backend user interface and the API. It's when you basically install MISP, you have this part. And then, when you basically did Git submodules in it, you get a lot of additional informations that are basically part of the MISP project that we are working on, but that can be reused by other projects. For example, the taxonomies, the warning lists, the galaxies, and even the object are format libraries that we maintain. And those ones can be reused by other tools. So for example, the taxonomies are what we call a kind of global tagging system. So we'll go into details later on about how it's used and so on. But it's basically libraries. And those libraries can be done by everyone. It's very simple to use. And some other tools are using it. For example, what we try to do is we try to streamline all the tools that we have at Circle that are using the same taxonomies. So for example, ALE, which is an analysis information leak framework that we have at Circle, basically use the same taxonomies on MISP. So like that, when you find a leak, it's pushing MISP, same taxonomies, same classification, nothing changed. And that's the thing that we try to do. All those taxonomies are public domains, people can reuse them in any tools. We have seen already many tools using it, and that's really the idea behind. We really want that people are contributing on that. Then we go on to the galaxy. Galaxy are much more advanced than the taxonomy. So instead of having simple key value informations, you can have complete set of informations, starting from adversaries. For example, the attack model from Maitre, it's within the galaxy as this. But if you have a new attack model that you design or your organization has specific, for example, preventive measures that are defined, you can create them in the galaxy. And you can even use those. Then same for the warning list. Those lists are a list of things that can generate false positive, and we maintain those lists too. We recently extended, it's close to 1 year, and in MISP for the object. So that means now you can even define your own data format within Wisp. So that's the thing that we were missing some times ago, where you can really define what you want to share. So if you really want to compose your own object, that's the way to go. And those are libraries that you can reuse. You can basically create a new one if you want. You can have your private one, or you can have public one that you share with us that everyone can know about.
Okay. Basically, one of the most important things that we've discovered over years and years of working on this was that the context is becoming more and more important over time. The more advanced detection tools, the more advanced methodologies are getting, the more important context is becoming. So what we're trying to do with all of these JSON libraries that Alexandre has listed here is to kind of build a common language for describing these two different types of things. We're not just communicating MIST to MIST, we're communicating MIST with other tools, with other communities out there, and so on. And what we want to do is we want to standardize on the nomenclatures that we're using and the way we describe things. Initiatives like ATT&CK, what Alexandre has mentioned, are fantastic for this because they're taking a massive aspect of what is being shared and building a standardized library around it on how you define that thing. And this is exactly what we're trying to incorporate here. And what we encourage everyone to do is, if you're building any other tool that is describing anything related to this field, have a look at these libraries just to get either ideas or to take them directly. So all of these JSON structures are CC0, you can reuse them in any other tool out there. And to just standardize a little bit on how we define things, because that will make everyone's lives easier when we're exchanging information.
And in addition to that, we extend it with a module. So it's basically a way to extend MISP itself without changing anything in the core to add new functionalities, including expansions, import, export, and so on. Tomorrow we'll go into details on how to write your own modules in Python, but you have already a large set of modules. I mean, you have expansion for various total and so on, you have various import formats that you can basically use in MISP and so on. So I invite you to have a look at the modules, you have a lot of things there. So going back to the functionalities, and that's something that we are still discussing and struggling sometimes, people ask, what is MISP? Is it a trade intelligence platform, or is it an information sharing exchange platform? To be honest, we don't really care about the name. So as long as it works and is doing its job, it's fine. But the thing is, you know, people try to put names on things. So maybe today we are a trade information sharing platform. Maybe in the next 2 years we will be an information exchange platform. We don't know. But that's basically, it's an open source software. That's something important too. MISP is an open source project and will remain in any case. We have a strong policy regarding copyright assignment. So we don't assign, and that's not very common for other projects. It's that you have two schools, I would say, but our strategy is the following. We don't assign copyright assignment to ourselves. So that means every author keeps their rights. So what we want to do is basically to ensure that the software always remains free and open. So what we do, we lock the software by having different contributors. So right now we have multiple copyright owners of the software. So if you want to change the license, tough luck. I mean, it's like the Linux kernel. You basically have many contributors, you cannot change the license. So that's really the idea behind. We don't want to avoid, because we have seen that in many open source projects where people force you to sign what they call a CAL, so which is basically a copyright assignment license, where you basically give away your rights to an organization and a foundation, whatever, that take care of it. You have to trust the organizations. And I would advise to not trust us. I mean, just keep your rights. So what we do with contribution and so on, everyone keeps their rights. And that's very important for us because that means the software itself remains open source and it's becoming used in critical infrastructures, in critical operations and so on. And we really want that people have no lock-in or dependency on other software. So that's why it's really important. And that, this one has a kind of different aspect too. We don't use a lot of libraries or dependencies within MISP. So we are quite strict regarding the usage of the software that we do in MISP. So to be sure that if you operate a MISP, you are basically in the legal boundary for the licensing and so on. But in addition to that, you don't depend too much of other development or software that might be at risk. So basically the functionalities, we will cross all the functionalities to this, we'll get demo and so on. But there are a lot of functionality, but one of the core one is the correlations. From the early beginning, what we have seen in MISP, correlation is really the thing that you want to have in a an intelligence platform needs to be automatic, it needs to work as expected, and you can basically do whatever you want with the correlation. So the correlation engine in MISP is growing. You have multiple functionalities. For example, you have what we call one-to-one correlation, so basically correlating on same value. We have even fuzzy hashing correlations. So you can say, for example, for the one using SSDeep, you want sometimes to want to correlation between two fuzzy hash and find similar things. So we do such kind of correlation. We do correlation at a network level with a CIDR block too. So you can basically set an IP address, it's matching a CIDR block. And the correlation engine is able even to be disabled for specific values. So you can say, I want to have correlation on that or not that. So we will go into detail on that. But I think this one is a core aspect because you see that when you start to have more and more information, more you have correlations, more you get insight of your information. Then another thing that is really important, and that's why it's an open source project too, we really want that people do whatever they want with the systems, like importing in their format that they like and exporting. So we don't want to have like a lot of tools, for example, get a lot of import, but there's no way to export the information because they want to keep you, you know, in a jail. But it's not the case here. We really want that people can export the data. We have seen that people that are just using MISP for transport mechanism, so they have MISP on a site, getting data and pushing back the data into their own trade intelligence platforms or another proprietary software, we are all fine with that. Some people are using MISP for everything, some are using for just part of it. We don't care. To be honest, as long as people can use it, get the data in, get the data out, is very important. And that's why the recent changes that we did in the API, we really want to expose more from the API perspective that we have the same way of querying the data for the different format that we have.
Maybe something here to also mention is that this is, of course, one of the most critical parts when you're integrating the tool in your network is what kind of formats can it speak and what kind of formats do I need to feed my various devices. So, of course, again, we have a very limited scope of what we can see on what tools are out there, what tools people use. Let us know if something's missing. So we're always curious about that. If you have any tools that are proprietary, also, we can work with you, give us the specifications, API descriptions, and so on, and we can either help you make it happen or we can build it for you, depending on needs of the community and so on.
And exactly for extension of things, we have the MISP modules. So if you want to extend with different things, I invite you to have a look at the list of MISP modules. We have a ton of those. The protocol that we use for the MISP modules, it's even compatible with Cortex, which is part of the Hive. So that means from the Hive, you can use MISP modules, and from MISP modules, you can use Cortex expansions. So we always try to integrate with other tools, especially open source tools that are basically supporting the format and so on. And it's a nice way because sometimes you might want to run MISP modules at some places, someone you want to use Cortex at other places. So we standardize even on the protocol aspect of expansion and so on. So to not have, you know, 10 times at 10 different places, your virus total keys, you can set, okay, I would use the expansion at that place and use it from different tool set.
Yeah. Something else that always comes up, and this is something that we're going to talk more extensively about tomorrow, is choosing the right format for the right tool. Very often you will see tools that support many different formats. Our policy is basically, we have an RFC for our standards and how we exchange information. We encourage you not to use that when feeding specific tools that have their own format. So, for example, if you're feeding an IDS, having something bloated that has all the metadata around it doesn't make sense to use to feed that tool. So this is why we have a lot of conversion tools in MISP. So the most optimized when you're feeding Suricata IDS is Suricata and not something else that is going to be thrown at it and then converted while it is actually ingesting the data. So whenever you're building your own topology inside your organization, have a look at what makes the most sense to export and which APIs to trigger from this when you're fetching the data out there to feed those various tools.
Yeah, for example, what we try to do is you can use MISP to convey direct information in specific format. So we don't really care that people are using, for example, sometimes SAG Sigma for describing SIM queries, and at the same time, you have someone else using IARA for specific things. So I think it's really important. There is no one format that will rule everything out. We really think that it's basically a mix of things that need to be covering specific aspects. And I mean, we know that IARA rules are very successful for doing binary search in binaries and stuff like that, which is not maybe some export for Suricata is able to do. So you have really, you really need to have the support for those different formats. So then a little thing about what is miss the software and the community. So that's the different things. Now, if you have a misprinting, but you are basically running a community. Maybe it's a community within your organizations. Maybe it's a community with different organizations. So it's different kind of communities.
Yeah, maybe one thing to clarify here at this point is that MISP itself, the software, can be either self-hosted, that means you install it and you're completely decoupled from the world and nobody has any access to it. You can interconnect with certain peers that you're interested in. We ourselves have no knowledge of who installs MISP and who's running it, basically. So we only know of the people that are interconnecting with us. So it's a peer-to-peer model. You set it up in your own infrastructure and you connect to whoever you want to connect to and whoever allows you to connect to them. The other thing is sometimes for some organizations when they're starting out, the natural first step is instead of installing MISP, to ask for access and to be able to use someone else hosted MISP. So we have our MISP as well. You can either connect to it via your own MISP or you can get access to it directly and then you can just log in and do things on there. Having your own MISP always has a bunch of advantages, such as being able to keep information that is not shared to anyone out there. For example, if you're sharing something that is only for your organization, our instance, of course, we have access to the SQL database and so on. We can get that information. So for that reason, it's better to host your own instance, keep all your internal data on there. We don't want anything to have anything to do with that, and then exchange what you want with partners. The other thing is there are some functionalities that only work locally if you're running your own MISP, but we're going to get to that later on. But basically, always keep these different models of how you can use MISP in mind. Self-hosted, logging into someone else's MISP, or even self-hosted completely in island mode and just using it for internal tasks.
And then you can connect to one or more multiple communities. You can even bridge some communities. So the thing is with MISP, the model is really flexible. So you can basically have different kind of groups that are connecting to. You can even share some data with some others, just pull from others. It's quite flexible. We'll go into detail this afternoon about all the synchronization aspects and how you can synchronize between two MISP instances. But the interesting part is the different kind of communities. For example, at Circle, we operate around 7 communities nowadays. One of the biggest one is what we call private sector one. So if you want to get access to that one, you can just send us an email at info@circle.lu and we'll send you the procedures to get access to it. And this one is a significant, I would say, user base. A lot of people are contributing, a lot of users are contributing, but it's really one an active community. But we have specific communities that are more targeting things like Telecom Operator 1, that are more linked to GSM member for the mobile operator, or those ones are more for the telecom aspect. Then you see different kind of communities that are popping up. Maybe some of you are part of those private clubs in security. They might run their own MISP, but they don't share to anyone. That's still fine. Like Andrej mentioned, you can basically run a MISP instance for your specific club. If you want to run a MISP community for your neighborhood to do like monitoring of cars that are basically crossing your neighborhood, feel free. I mean, it's MISP design can be designed for that. That's something that people can basically have. And then you see that some of the organizations that are really strict on not connecting to others, for example, the military sectors, where usually they don't connect freely depending on some models, but usually they don't connect. In MISP, we have some design where you can even have air gap systems. And then you can even really run a completely nylon mode MISP instance without even getting data in, or with an air gap, you can even get the data. And then you see even communities that are coming from security vendors that are running really their own community of MISP. For a specific use case. I mean, Fidelis one is really one on malware and remote access tools. This one is really sharing information about configuration of that, but it's really focused. And then you have even other sharing communities that are not using MISP at this, but they are bridging it. For example, OTX Alien Vault is getting data in from different communities. So you can really run different kind of communities, but there is a clear separation. As MISP project, we basically develop the software, and then at Circle, we run different communities, but some of them are running communities and so on. So you might have private ones. You might have even commercial ones that are specific to a vendor, so specific to an organization and so on. But you can really build your own different communities. Another thing that we operate right now is Cross ISAC, which is an ISAC community for bridging ISACs. Because you know, in the world, you might have different information sharing analysis centers that are working alone, But at some point, you need to bridge those because they are in different sectors of activities. And we try to support that functionalities, and we extend Lisp even to better support those kind of things. So going back to that, and this one is really the initial model from Lisp, and I think it's really important. There is no things like a consumer and producer. Everyone can consume, everyone can produce, and you can really basically decide whatever you like for specific events, specific information that you want to share. So, and that's really important for us. There is no model, hierarchical model. Some model of getting information is like you have a trusted source and nothing else. It's a bit different in Lisp. You can basically just even on trusted source, you can even say you don't even agree on a specific one. There's a functionality that we will show to you. It's called extended event. For example, if you have a report that you get from a antivirus vendors and you don't agree at all, you can do an extended event that will be private to yours, and you see in Lisp the same event. And that's quite interesting because you can basically really contextualize information really depending on your context. And like Andras mentioned, it's basically depending on your organizations. I mean, if you are based in Luxembourg or you are based in Belarus, you might have different threat actors and you might have different contextual information. So it's fine. I mean, it's all fine, but you still need to get the information, and then you can even extend it with your own contextual information. So the extended event functionality is really an interesting one. And thing that we try to do is basically that people have, if they access the platform, they have a kind of easy way to use it. It's not completely intuitive for the first time, but when you start to see other events and other information, it makes sense and you can start to contribute back. Some words about terminology and so on, and I think I think it's quite important. It's not too much theory, but it's quite important. In Lisp itself, you will have a lot of things about events, discussion about events, attributes, and objects. So, and that's very important. For Lisp itself, an event is basically just an envelope that is contextualizing a same information. An event could be an incident, but it could not be two. It could be, for example, a report. It could be an analysis.
It could be the daily report of the cars passing your street.
One, for example, the neighborhood use case.
Exactly.
It could be, for example, like your Honeypot dataset that you get every day. It could be your sandbox report. For example, I know some servers that are sending out the sandbox report on a daily basis to everyone. Might be useful for correlation and so on. So event is basically just an envelope around it. So you can do whatever you want with the event. Then, at a lower level, you have those kind of elements or basic elements that are what we call attributes. And those ones are multiple types, multiple formats, and usually they are cybersecurity indicators, but nowadays they can be extended to financial indicators. Yeah. Bank account.
Maybe the best way to think of it is it's a single point of data with context around it. So saying that this is an IP address that was seen in this context, this is a domain name seen in this context, and so on. So basically, attributes are basic building blocks, which we then can use to create something more complex using the objects, which is the next element, which is basically a scaffolding system for binding these atomic building blocks together into something more coherent. And then all of these are again encapsulated in an event, which is the main container that we have.
Yeah. And those type of attributes are really coming on usage. So we have no committee deciding of what is good or what is bad. We basically import it if it's used. I mean, for example, recently we get a request for Monero addresses, which is kind of Bitcoin addresses, but for Monero, we just import it because it's useful. I mean, a lot of people, attackers are using Monero, so it makes sense. So we really have those attribute types based on usage. It's easy to extend, and then those ones are used for describing those objects where you can make compositions of different attributes together to specify a specific object.
One of the other main reasons why we have this separation between objects and attributes is because we try to be as lax as we can with certain things for you to be able to extend it. So an attribute, the basic building block, is something that is more difficult to extend by the community because it is something that has to be validated. An IP address has a certain format, a hash has a certain format. These things need to have more processing behind it on what you accept and what you throw away. On the other hand, the templating and the scaffolding system is something that we want to leave up to the users to define their own. We, of course, provide a large set of default object templates, But sometimes you might think, okay, using these basic building blocks that exist out there, I want to build my own object that describes, for example, the output of a tool I have. Mm-hmm. So in that case, it makes absolute sense to do that.
Yeah, and usually even building your own object is a work of like 30 minutes. And then you can even share it back with Mist that doesn't know about the object. So it's really a way to describe new things that you really that are really focusing on your organizations. Then going back to the attributes aspect, and that's, I think, very important. Very often you heard about indicators. So what are the difference between indicators and attributes in Mist? I'll take a simple example, MD5. You receive by email a list of MD5. So usually what do you assume? It might be file hashes of malware, or it might be a whitelist of malware. Or it could be, for example, the MD5 of the X509 certificate. Or maybe it's the MD5 of an output of a pickup file or a disk acquisition. So it's tough. You don't exactly know what it is. So in MISP, from the early beginning, we said like, for us, it was like a kind of, I would say, problem as a third. We really want to have context around the information. And by default, in MISP, when you have an attribute, it's basically much more than just an indicator. You have a type associated to it. So if you have an MD5 values, you can have MD5 values that are linked to a X509 certificate, or it can be an MD5 value that is basically linked to samples. And then we have a category. Those categories define in which context you get the information. So for example, if you payload delivery, but you know that this MD5 has been received through emails, through injection, whatever. So that's very important. And then we have an additional information, which is what we call the IDS flag, which is, I think, should be named automation flag. So this flag is basically telling you, okay, this information is interesting, but either you can use it for automations, like using an IDS for detections, for blocking, whatever. But if you don't set the IDS flag, it's maybe interesting for contextual information. An example, you receive an IP addresses, and then this IP addresses is basically a Google server. But you have a malware, when you do the analysis, that is basically connecting to that one. So you still want to share the information because it's contextual information. This IP addresses, I've seen it, this malware is obviously testing the internet connectivity by using this Google server, but I don't want to use it as a pure detection, but I still want to share this information. And that's why in attribute in MISP, you have those three kind of information. And the IDS flag helps you to define, okay, it's just contextual information, or is it something that I can automate on?
Sometimes it's also historic data that was relevant at one point but isn't anymore. So that is also a mechanism used for that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And something that you have to think about it is attributes can be obviously indicator of compromise, which is a subset of indicators. So meaning that usually an indicator of compromise would have the IDS flag set, because it's basically something that you can automate on, a type and a category. But what we try to do is not to be too complex. So by default, MISP try to figure out. So if you just have a list of MD5, but you don't exactly know, because you know that, okay, 95% of the time, this list of MD5 is a sample of malwares. Automatically, it will be a payload delivery and related to a malware. So that's the thing that we try to do. And it's quite important in MISP because if you don't have this contextual information, we try to guess it. We have an automatic list that is basically telling you, okay, this type of attribute might fall into that category. Okay, so another thing that we, and this one is a tough one for us because it means that we have to maintain a lot of API and software and so on. And this coming from our use case. I mean, maybe some people around here are used to do malware reversing. Some people are maybe used to do analysis, maybe some incident response and so on. And you know, sometimes it's painful to switch over interface. Like, for example, if you have IDA Pro, you are working into it, you do reversing and so on, but you don't want to basically go to a Java interface to fill a web interface to just put the indicator that you already get from your analysis extraction from your IDA. So what we try to do, we don't try to not force people to use a single interface. So in the demo, we'll show you that the different way of adding information, and you'll see that you have, like, officially from the user interface, you have already five different ways to add information directly in MISP. So it's really trying to focus on different use cases. And then, for example, if you have like senior analysts that always use, for example, Viper directly for doing their analysis, they can do it from Viper. But if you have like service desk people that doesn't know about all the details about the attacks, but want to use a template with information and that's it, that's fine. And we try to basically have this kind of way of doing it in MISP
to avoid to force people to use a single interface. Because for us, it was already, a major issue when we had such kind of tools, so we don't want to reproduce that. So we tried that. The only drawback for us, more code to maintain, so more potential bugs, so more issues. But that's fine, we try to work with that. So we'll go into detail, but for example, the free text import was one of those kind of things where it's a quick thing. So always we are thinking about flow. When you get incident response, very often you receive an email from someone in the ticketing system, oh, have you looked at this? And you have a bunch of text, you have some indicators, so you have to look into it. So what you can do in MISP, you can just paste everything into this free text import, just press OK, and then automatically we'll try to figure out, is there an indicator or potential indicator there? And automatically we'll just display all the information and show you the correlation even. So if you see that you have already correlations, okay, you know about it, you have an event, that's it, discard it. Then you can, okay, you read the email. You can do that in 5 seconds, which is, I think, a quick advantage.
One of the things that we noticed was that one of the biggest hurdles for information sharing was not technical, was not legal, and so on, was simply that it gets in the way. So if you have someone that has their daily process and they have enough on their plate anyway, and having to encode the data in a specific format, they're going through tools and so on, can be a hassle. So we want to make that part of your process without getting in your way. So one of the things that, and this is why we're trying to integrate with as many tools out there, offer as many APIs as possible, is you should be able to just hook it into your process wherever and have it as quickly done as possible. And this is one of those typical things. If you're more of a UI user, you're getting emails in and so on, just copy paste the whole thing into this box and then you get all the indicators out, share it in raw format and let someone else, for example, report false positives back that come from that. So that's an option.
For example, we have this kind of interface exposed through the API, so not only from the user interface, so you can even use this one directly from other tools.
Yeah.
Another thing that we have, it's we have mail to MISP systems where you can even input information into MISP from a mail. So imagine that you receive emails from a trusted group or you receive emails from potential spear phishing and so on. You just drop the email, automatically an event will be created. In MISP, you can set some parameters. We might talk about it today or tomorrow. Yeah.
Something that is interesting here, and this is something that we're going to talk a lot about during these 2 days, is having a small network of MISPs internally. And this is exactly the use case that Alexandre just mentioned. We, for example, have a MISP where we're just getting a lot of spam in. So it's using mail to MISP. It's populating it incredibly quickly with data. This is data that we don't want to share out to the community because most of it is junk. It's any spam email that we get in there. However, what we do is we go through those emails, and if we see something relevant, we move it over to our sharing community MISP, and then it gets shared out to the community. So this is something to always keep in mind, is spinning up an extra MISP instance takes about as much time as spinning up any other VM or any other server. So just a few internal MISP instances that you use for your automated processes, one hooked up to your sandbox, to your spam emails, and so on, and then do the filtering afterwards, and share it back to the community. At least the relevant parts.
Yeah. And having multiple MISP instances can be connected together, and they are part of the same organization. So we'll show in two details how to configure that part later on. But I think it's very important because, I mean, nowadays we have like 10 instances at the office where that we use for various things, including for testing, for sandboxes, for spam and so on, for distributions, for analysis. So you can do it, and it's part of the design of MISP. Things about classifications, we have a lot of slides about the classification aspect and so on, but it's again coming from a mistake that we did initially. A lot of people were basically sharing informations, but they were creating their own tags. So they were like using free taggings. And that was a problem. For example, a lot of people were very creative to describe specific things, like TLP, for example. And the taxonomy really started from one single problem, TLP classifications. And a lot of people were writing TLP in different ways. TLP dash amber, semicolon amber, space in between, with slash, we had all the variations. And we were like, okay, maybe people should start to use a kind of global classifications. They can select out of it, and then we can share the same way of expressing it. And that's where the classifications come back. And then later on, we introduce functionalities that are, for example, the occurrence of specific tags over time. And then you can see, for example, that if an increase in specific classifications, and that works for everything. If you have ransomware classifications, you automatically see the ransomware classification increase and so on. So these kind of things were like I would say, granularly integrated into MISP. And nowadays, we have even more than 42 nowadays, but the thing is, you can really extend it. And sometimes people say, oh, it's tough. You have to choose between different taxonomies. It's up to you. You can choose whatever you like. The thing is just there to support the organization. For example, if you run a MISP that is sharing information that are not military and classified, maybe you want just a subset of it. You just want to have the unclassified one to be sure that everything is unclassified. Or you can even cherry pick within the libraries the specific one that you want to use. And that's something that we try to do. Classification was for events, it's for attributes. You can use it at different things. From the API perspective, for example, all the search that you are doing can be done at tax space, but it can be done at namespace too. So if you want to have all the TLP classified information, you just search for that kind of information. So the thing that we have seen is the sharing. Sometimes people want to share information, and that's maybe a underused functionality in MISP. It's what we call delegations. So imagine that you are a bank in Luxembourg. You want to share information, but you want to not associate your names to that specific event. And that's quite important. Imagine that some people might see an event from a bank and might think that this event is related to an incident, which is maybe not the case. But they are still afraid to have this kind of association. So what they do, they create an event, which is private to them, and then they can delegate to someone else to publish the event. An example, you have a banking associations that are taking care of all the banks in Luxembourg. Those guys can basically take over and publish under their name. So you still have the benefit of sharing.